So I'll start now.
Yeah, ma'am, please continue.
Okay, so I was talking about government work. As I said, it's good work-life balance. There's high quality work. It was good variety. I was used to work very closely with the decision makers in government and ministers and stuff. So it was really high profile work in policy areas as well. So if you're interested in policy areas, government is a good area, and also legislative changes. And the negatives were that there was not too much exposure to international work. I had to be cautious in my personal life too, because I had other commitments, but I was accountable to the government for even those personal commitments. I had to be cautious of what I said publicly. After that many years, it got a bit boring for me, and there was not too much scope for going too much much higher, because I was a principal solicitor. There was only two levels above that, and a person of color from overseas is never going to become that. It's very difficult still to get those top roles. So I started my own practice after that. So that is only a year and a half ago. I was getting restless, and I saw the scope of servicing the growing Indian community. There's a lot of businesses that are growing here, and I thought there wasn't very good business lawyers from the Indian community here. So I thought I should, you know, try out that market as well, because people wanted someone who spoke their language. Took me 2 years to decide, but I started. I do mainly commercial work now, and my clientele is mainly migrant people. I think networking is really important for that. So I did a lot of networking in years before that. So I had a client base when I started, went out on my own. Now, the benefits, of course, are that you get a lot of independence. And then also, because I'm servicing my own community and filling a market segment, is really satisfying for me as well, to deal with people from my own community. I've created a niche for myself in that area as well. I have my own flexible hours. I have got a young daughter, so I want to spend time with her. And I have time to pursue my other interests. I have the work-life balance. So I do a lot of that. I have a lot of interest in sports. So I sit on boards and things. So I do that outside of my work. As we all know, you get to keep what you earn. So that's a benefit. Some of the disadvantages of having your own practice is that the infrastructure is not there that you can be used to. You have to build it all yourself, do all the work yourself, which is quite difficult. The high cost of running in compliance, especially in Australia, the cost of compliance are very high. You have to pay a lot of insurance. And if you have employees and you manage trust accounts, the cost becomes higher. Rent and other bills. There's the uncertainty of work. Sometimes it's good, sometimes it's not. There's a lot of work to be done in marketing, but I'm still enjoying it. I'm not looking to build a massive practice, but I want to do things that I really enjoy. I've started doing sports work as well, which is really interesting. And some sports tech companies and some other companies, even some in India, who are looking to get some advice from me on sports law. And I also sit on the football tribunal, which is an adjudicatory role as well, so which is really interesting. So some of the other options are, you know, you can go into teaching, lecturing, or research. You can either do it full-time or part-time with your existing work. Some people actually have a practice here, at least they practice as a lawyer, but they can also go and lecture part-time at a university. And I think you can do that in India as well. It depends on whether you enjoy that. I sometimes lecture at universities here or talk on panels, but that's ad hoc. I've been invited to speak at universities in India as well, including Delhi University, Campus Law Center, Jindal, Ansal, etc. I quite enjoy that aspect. I enjoy doing it, and I enjoy interacting with students. So if that's what you love, you would probably enjoy the lecturing aspect. I'm not sure the income may not be very high in teaching, but it's a stable job as well. I would probably not go into full time, but other people really enjoy that aspect. And it's a good option as well if you prefer academics to practice, and you get a lot of options to do research as well and work on in areas that you're particularly keen to work on. Then the other option is judiciary as well. Obviously my grandfather was a judge, so I saw that in my house. I saw the work ethic, and he really inspired me to become a lawyer, I think. You can get into lower judiciary through an exam, but the higher judiciary is by appointment. In Australia, all of it is by appointment, even the lower judiciary. There are also tribunals and appellate bodies both there and here on which you can get appointed as well, which are judicial roles. So there's some openings there as well. Of course, a lot of it can be political these days, and you've got to have the connections to get into judiciary. But I think it's still a real, I feel there's a lot more men in that industry than women in the judiciary. It's a prestigious position, especially in India, because judges sometimes make law as well in the name of judicial activism, which is great. In Australia, they're not that adventurous. The black letter of law is really strong, so they don't have that much flexibility, but they're still, obviously, it's a very good. Disadvantages, not too many, but you don't expect to earn too much, but that's but you have so many other perks that make up for it. You're always in the public eye and scrutiny, so therefore subject to much higher standards of work and behavior. So if you're not particularly keen on that lifestyle, then that's not for you. The civil services exams, you can go and do civil services after that as well. A lot of people, I remember when I was studying law, used to sit for the exams as well. It gives you good grounding. Governance is another area you can do. Future of governance, which is sitting on boards. I sit on 5 or 6 boards myself. There, some of them are massive, massive organizations with $200 million. Some are small, sports boards, gymnastics, football, and others. You can either be on the corporate or you can or a not-for-profit. Some of them are paid board positions, some are not. But they're really enjoyable. It's really good work. It's basically the strategic oversight of an organization. You give strategic directions to the organization or the management, overview of the operations and risk setting. So all the big decisions of the organization are basically taken by the board, including financial. So that's a good option as well. I think you'd ask me to speak about OPP, but I'm not really familiar with that. We do have it here. But it's again by appointments here. So you can work in that office as a job, but the appointment of that is by the government. So that's pretty much it from me. And I'm happy to answer any questions that you may have.
Ma'am, what is the scope of air law, space law, and sports law?
In Australia? There is. It's definitely growing areas, all of them. Sports law is probably bigger than space law and others, but I think there's a lot of work in those areas. I'm not sure about India, but I think it's growing in India as well, but there's few people who are doing that work here also. It's always a niche area here, but the scope is there in the future, I think.
So we have a question from Kritika Taneja. Ma'am, where you have done LLB from, and do you think there are good corporate firm jobs for 3-year LLB students?
So I did my LLB 3 years after my BCom degree from Campus Law Center, law faculty. So that was, at that time, obviously was a good one still. It still is a good university, I think. There are jobs, of course, there's jobs for people who finish 3 years as well, but I think you'll get more of it seems to be, because I don't practice there anymore, but I think it's more in litigation and, smaller offices where you'll get a job, because the big firms have become quite particular about the 5-year course and about you having some internship experience and all that. So that's what I've heard from my experience of when I speak to people in India, that you still get it, but litigation, which is not a bad option. I think it's a good place to start anyways. Any other questions?
Ma'am, Amaranchul is asking, which are the top universities in Australia for LLM?
So the best one is Melbourne University. That's number one in the world. Number one in Australia, and it ranks from between 6 to 9 or something, changes every year. So that's the best university. Then you also have the ANU, which is the Australian National University. And then you have Monash University, which is decent enough. Maybe University of New South Wales may be all right. So these are the top ones, but there's others as well. Deakin and La Trobe, which offer the courses as well, but they're not as highly ranked.
Can you tell the scope of BBA LLB for National Law University students?
BA LLB for?
BBA LLB.
Non-national, okay. For non-national, not NLU ones. I suppose there is always scope. There's a lot of work that goes on. India is a litigating country, I feel. There's a lot of legal work that goes on. The commercial work may be a bit difficult, as I said before, because people are looking for that 5 year, that other kind of NLU or big, you know, good university, that the top universities, all universities are good, I'm sure, but just the top university ones. But I think there would be scope, definitely worth trying out there and seeing what is available. I think good option is also to work with some good senior who's doing amazing work, so they, you think you get good exposure through that as well. Even if it's a small firm or a small litigation firm, I think the experience is still good. You get exposure to a lot of people. I would always suggest, if you don't get opportunities directly in these circumstances, network a lot. Do a lot of work outside of your normal, you know, things that you do. Do participate in extracurriculars, in mooting, in organizations. Be part of student organizations or legal organizations. Attend seminars. Speak when you get the opportunity. Though that puts you in the limelight, and you're more likely to get a job after that.
Ma'am, we have a question from Ria Gulati. What else can one explore after doing LLB except in corporate sector?
What do you mean? I mean, I've spoken about all the various options already.
Like judiciary, be a law professor.
Yeah, you can work in if you don't want to work in corporate, there's you can work in any company as well. You can go and apply for another corporate job. A legal degree is always counted as good experience. You can do an MBA on top if you want, and you can get a managerial role as well. Teaching, as I said, is a good one. Government jobs, that's also possible, but you have to obviously sit through. I think in India you have to.
You can also appeal for the public prosecutor exam. We have a question from Tariq Ahmed. How to get job in good law firms?
How to get job in good law firms? I mean, it all depends on your marks sometimes and your experience. Sometimes if your marks are not that great, but you've been doing really good work while you were studying, then take up any opportunity you get while you're studying to do internships, do extracurricular work. As I said, take on initiatives, start something yourself if you want to. Try and be more visible, more active. Go and talk to people directly, like I did. I couldn't, because of recruiters here, I didn't get a chance to, they weren't putting forward my CV because I didn't tick all the boxes. So I was going to a meeting directly, talking to partners of firms. So seek them out, try to find those people and go talk to them and tell them this is what.
Can I ask the next question, ma'am?
Yes.
Just a second. What is the importance of specialization? Like, one should specialize in a particular field or like...
It depends what you want to do eventually. You can specialize here. It really depends on what you want to do eventually, because you can specialize. If you want to work for a big law firm, yes, you will have to specialize because that's how they work. But if you're working for a smaller firm, I find general commercial a lot more interesting because you get a variety of work. But specialization can help you, once you specialize in that area, you can get a job anywhere in that area. So if you're working here, you can get in Dubai, in Europe, wherever, in that specialized area if you've worked at the top level. So maybe in that sense, it helps to specialize, but not everyone gets that opportunity to work all the time in these big firms. So if you don't get that opportunity, I think general commercial is also quite useful to do.
So ma'am, as per your vast experience, can you please enlighten what was the best experience, whether in litigation, corporate, after doing LLB, judicial service, solicitor, or anything other you would like to suggest?
For me, I think always the most exciting thing was always litigation. I loved litigation. So that was always fun for me and always very exciting, and I felt I was making a difference. The public interest litigation side especially was something I absolutely loved. So for me, that is still my first love, I would say. But I've learned to love commercial as well. I enjoy it, but I don't love it like I like I did litigation. Because everyone's interests are quite different. Some people really love human rights law. I mean, I do that work, but outside of my commercial work, that is, I do that pro bono. So it depends on what your where your passion really lies. Follow your passion, you can't go wrong.
So Amaranchul is asking, can you please tell us the scope of doing LLM in commercial laws in New Zealand, and what and how easy and how it is and how easy it is to getting a job there in New Zealand?
I am not very familiar with New Zealand because I haven't practiced there, but I think it's very similar to Australia. There must be some good universities. I'm not sure which one is the best one over there. You'll have to do your own research. But again, it's the same thing. You have to go through the process of qualifying if you want to do a job, because even by doing an LLM, you won't get a job there. You will have to re-qualify to practice there. So you might be asked to do a number of subjects and training again, and then start applying. And then if you're competing with the local graduates, it's the same thing. You might come across the same hurdles. You might not be able to get a job. A lot of the people I found here in Australia have gone back to India and they found good jobs in India. More scope for them to work in India than working here. So it might be similar in New Zealand. I'm not 100% sure, as I said, because New Zealand is a completely different country.
We have a question from Ahona. What do you think is the scope of law in the defense? In what way can one be a judge in the Army, Navy or Air Force Tribunal? It is through JAG entrance in India, but I don't know how it can be done in Australia. Ma'am, is there anything like in same in Australia as well?
No, not really. There's such tribunal, because I haven't heard of it. But even if it was, it'll be by appointment, because here it's not through exam or anything. Everything is by appointment. Even if I have to become a magistrate, I have to be appointed by the Attorney General. So I have to make an application. Of course, there's so many people make applications. Eventually, it's a lot of political connections. Most of the appointments in Australia are political, because it depends on which government is in power. They will be the one appointing. So sometimes they're independent, but they're not always. So here it is all about appointment. Defense forces, I haven't heard that much here. In India, probably, I'm sure, because there's a huge army and air force and everything, so there would be good opportunities there. Not that I know here. I don't think it would have any scope.
So Shweta is asking, if I want to clear judiciary, so whether I should do LLM first or should I directly prepare for judicial exams?
You don't need to do an LLM to prepare for the judicial exams. You can go directly as well. There's obviously a lot of preparatory material that might be available. You've got to prepare that. I don't think you need to do an LLB. If you practice, that's good. I think it's good to be practice for some time. Then if you give the exam, you're probably in a better placed than just going raw straight out of, you know, you probably aren't. You need 2-3 years of experience or something to sit for the exam.
Shivani Rajput is asking, what is the scope of maritime law?
Maritime law is interesting. It's quite an upcoming area. In fact, because of so many matters that have happened in the recent past in the South China Sea matters and others, maritime law does have good scope. But there's not huge amounts of work. There's a few firms that will specialize in that, and not everyone can just get into that area that easily or start practicing, because the work is very limited. So either you start working with a firm that is doing that, then you will get good opportunity to learn and practice in that area. But you'll always have to work for a firm, because individually nobody really does, unless you're a barrister and you specialize in maritime law here. As in here, you need to be a barrister. Otherwise, you probably need to work for a firm that is doing that.
Ma'am, please let us know the scope of students pursuing 5-year integrated BSc LLB. So there is a new field of forensic law. Is there something like that, ma'am? Forensic lawyer?
Yeah, there can be forensic lawyers. There can also be medico, what is it? The ones that deal with the medical negligence and stuff. So you can do that as well. There is, I mean, I'm not sure of what the qualifications for someone like that are and how many there there are, because I don't work in the criminal area, I haven't come across, but probably there would be. I presume here we have the coroner's court, and the coroner's court usually investigates into deaths like that, and maybe in that area they might be calling upon experts, and if someone is an expert in that forensic area, they might be called upon to give evidence.
So what specialization in LLM would you suggest?
I would say commercial law, because I mean, it totally depends on what you want to do. Some people want to go into human rights. So I think someone was asking about UN as well. I saw something pop up. So if you do a master's in international law, public international law or things like that, then there are more chances that you can get something in the UN, more chances of you to get into UN. But also, it depends on your area of interest. Do it in the area that you want to actually practice in. If you want to specialize, don't do it for the sake of doing it. I did it in commercial law because I wanted to practice. I was practicing in commercial law. I wanted to upskill myself in commercial law. If you want to practice in media law, you could do it in that. If you want to practice in some other area, do that. But do it only on what you want to really do in the long term. And you should. And as I had said, you should only do your master's after a few years of working, so you will know what your interest is anyway, so you won't waste your time doing a master's which is not useful in the long run.
So what exams one needs to take to get into a foreign university for LLM? So there is different procedure. Yeah,
so different universities in different countries have, you have to sit through those exams. Like here you have to give a language exam as well, IELTS. And you have to have a certain score to be able to get into universities. So that exam needs to be given. But otherwise, other than that, to do an LLM, you just have to make an application. So when I applied, I just put in applications to a few universities. They're quite very comprehensive applications about why you want to do it and your experience and background and all that stuff. So you have to put that in. So I did it. And luckily, I got into the best university. So after that, I didn't have to worry about anything else. But I think most of the universities require, it's an application process. But that IELTS, you have to definitely give for Australia. For other countries, Europe, UK, there's another probably exam, must be something similar. I remember having applied for a UK university when I was studying, when I had started practicing in India, but I eventually didn't go because I just decided not to. And so at that point in time, it wasn't that useful and it was quite expensive as well. But I think I applied and I got, my application was accepted.
We'll take 3 to 4 questions more.
Yeah.
Just a second. Is there any scope of doing company secretary during or after LLB for specialization in commercial laws?
Not for specialization in commercial law. If you want to become a company secretary, then yes. Or if you want to work in-house into a company, but a big company, sometimes they like someone having both those degrees. But mostly people who do company secretary end up doing company secretarial work rather than legal work. If you want to do legal, you don't necessarily require a company secretarial. I had started doing my the CS course as well when I started LLB, but it was just too much work. You can do one of them better than other. So it's easier to do just one rather than both of them because you don't do good in either then. So I'm not sure whether how useful it is unless you want to be a CS.
Is there any scope to move to higher judiciary after working in lower judiciary? Or it is only from the bar? And how well are lower judiciary judges paid?
How? What was the last part of the question?
No, your voice is breaking.
I was asking what is the last part of the question.
How well are lower judiciary judges paid?
Okay. I'm not sure how well they're paid. They pay decently well, I think, but they also have the perks, other perks as well. I think they get a house and car and all that stuff. So driver. So those kind of perks are there. I'm not sure of the salary because I won't know. I've left India so long ago. I didn't know that.
Is there any benefit of LLM?
Sorry, benefit?
Can you move to next question?
I didn't finish that one, but somebody was asking about the judges. You can be promoted. Yes, you can be promoted from magistrate to high court, but it's not that often. Yeah, we can move to the next question.
Yeah, so next question is from Shweta. Is there any benefit of doing LLM for judiciary? Like, if one wants to clear judiciary, so will LLM help in any field?
I don't think so. No. Not for that. LLM is good when you're practicing in a certain area. LLM is for that purpose. It's more for, I feel it's for either you want to practice in that area or you want to teach. It's only good for those areas. I don't think an LLM is useful for judiciary.
So we have a question from Kashish. How can one work for United Nations?
I had touched upon that before, that you can do that by working in the international law area. So if you work for a firm that is working in the international law area, you get opportunities. Also, there are some international organizations like the International Law Association. So I'm the Victorian president of that organization here in Australia. So for my state chapter, so I'm the president of that. So they have various committees. So you can appoint to get on a committee which is advising the UN. So through that, you get opportunities as well. So I've had people who have been in my team but have gone overseas to work for the UN through that as well. So that organization exists in India as well. So you can try through that.
Jasmine is asking, if one wants to land a job at an international firm abroad, how should he or she go forward, do an LLM and then apply for a job, or gain some experience in India and then apply?
As I said, you should do your LLM anyways after gaining some experience. So I don't think either or. I think you have to do both. So you have to work for a bit and then you do an LLM. That will probably put you in better chance. You have better chances of getting a job overseas. But that work experience in India should also be at a good firm where you've got the experience of working at the top level. Otherwise, the foreign firms are not very open to taking foreign practitioners because they already have too many local practitioners. The only reason they will take you is if you somehow add value to maybe they have an India desk and you can add some value because you've already created those relationships, not just for your knowledge. A lot of people have knowledge, but if you have the connections back home, you can bring them work, they might take you.
Last question.
Yeah.
What is the scope of media law?
Media law is gaining a lot, getting a lot of recent years, I've seen a lot of scope in media law as well. I do some bits and pieces. I have some friends who are filmmakers, so I've done some work for them. Basically, it's contractual work, a lot of commercial work. So media law is, a lot of it is to do with commercial contracts as well, but it could be related specifically to rights and obligations and freedom of speech and things like that. I think there is good scope.
So now we can end the session. Thank you so much, ma'am, for taking out time for the session and guiding us. And no problem. Thank you, everyone, for attending the session.